Dani Pedrosa, his 14th MotoGP front row, pole position. Three wins from those 13 poles. First in a Jerez in 2008. And in fact, in the last 4 years, he's been first or second here at Jerez. 250cc winner here in 2005, but only seventh in Qatar. Made that rocket start, you remember, from Qatar, from the third row of the grid. From the front row of the grid in pole position, he's probably going to be first into turn one.
But he was very, very disappointed, even though he set the pole position time yesterday. Understandably, he's saying, OK, one fast lap is OK, but it's unlikely that he'll be able to lap at the consistently enough to stay with the front runners in the race.
So Dani Pedrosa in pole position. Alongside him will be his great rival, Jorge Lorenzo. Lorenzo, I've got to say, probably out of anybody in the race today, has put in the most consistent fast laps on race tyres. Here is Dani Pedrosa. Very disappointed with the result in Qatar. Big, big year for the former 125 and 250cc world champion. His contract with Honda, but it's a year-long contract. Obviously ends at the end of this year. And he needs some good results. Problems with the bike in Qatar, certainly not particularly stable under braking, but I think they've made a few changes, Honda, and it does appear better, but not to his satisfaction just yet.
It seems the changes that they've been chasing to improve this stability have altered the way that the weight is transferred under braking, which actually both Repsol Honda riders have said that they're not so happy with. Doesn't really suit their style.
Tire choice looks like a hard front and a medium rear for certainly those top three riders, and I would imagine, Ian, for most of the riders.
Yeah, I would think so. I don't think anybody's going to take a chance on the tire choice here with the problems that they had with rear traction yesterday. I think we're going to see at least the front two rows, probably three rows on the same tire choice, but we'll have a look once the warmers start to come off.
With a long look at Dani Pedrosa. As I say, won the race here 2008, led the race here, you remember, last year before getting pulled back, but a great record at a race. First or second in the last 4 years in the MotoGP race, and also a former 250cc winner.
just to go back to the tyres a second there, Nick, we mentioned yesterday during qualifier that Aleix Espargaró on the Pramac Ducati was running a different setup using the soft rear at the start of qualifying, indicating that he might use it in the race. Well, I can confirm that Aleix Espargaró is the only rider on the grid who will use the softer option rear tyre today.
Yeah, well, I suppose with the position he's in, is take a risk. Look at the support for Jorge Lorenzo, who's qualified second fastest, been in pole here for the last 2 years, made his Grand Prix debut here in 2002. Couldn't ride on the Friday, he was too young, he was only 14, had to come into the second practice session on the Saturday when he was a 15. 250cc winner, 2006, 2007. Third in the MotoGP race in 2008 from pole position last year. Crashed out, second in Qatar. Completing the front row of the grid, the Australian Casey Stoner. Never had a lot of luck here in Jerez. Third in 2009, his only podium. Of course, he crashed out in Qatar while leading the race. Also had a crash in the first practice session on Friday afternoon here. But a lot happier with Ducati, who have not got a particularly good record in Jerez. Back down to Valentino Rossi, chasing his seventh Premier Class win in Jerez. He was telling us on Thursday, spent all his childhood here when he was a 125 and 250cc rider because all the testing was here. Seems okay about the shoulder injury he damaged in that motocross training accident. As he also said, same grid position as last year for Valentino Rossi. He went on to win the race. And wherever he is, anywhere in the world, support for Valentino Rossi just gets bigger and bigger. So Rossi on that second row of the grid. Alongside him, Nicky Hayden, fourth in Qatar. His only Jerez podium was a third place in 2006. A very, very big crash for Nicky Hayden on Saturday morning. I believe it was timed at 130 miles an hour when Nicky Hayden, the former world champion, crashed the Ducati. Did so well to complete that practice session on the second bike and also complete qualifying. Nicky Hayden has qualified in the middle of that second row. He has qualified fifth fastest. Completing the second row, Randy Depunier, the Frenchman riding the LCR Honda, fourth in the race here last year. He was another crasher on Saturday morning. Nothing like as spectacular as Nicky Hayden's crash. He was perfectly okay. And he started the season well with that sixth place in Qatar. The Frenchman in good form and put it in some consistent results last season and seemingly carrying on this year for the LCR team, the private team, the non-works team with the Honda machinery.
Nick, I'm down on the grid now with Nicky Hayden. Nicky, great result in Qatar. Practice and qualifying looks to have gone well for you. You had the small crash yesterday, but your race pace on race tyres looks good for this race.
Bike team's done a good job. I'm pretty happy with the bike, the setup, and make sure I know I could always do it more, but I have a good package. Hopefully I can turn it into a result today, so I'm really looking forward to where we go for it.
Well, good luck this afternoon, Nicky, and thanks.
Nicky Hayden, big season for him. The Americans are chasing up behind him. We saw Colin Edwards, who's qualified seventh fastest. Third in a race in 2007, eighth in Qatar. And the man that everybody in the MotoGP paddock is talking about at the moment, the world superbike champion, Ben Spies. His very first look at Jerez was on a Friday afternoon in practice, and he has qualified eighth fastest, following up that brilliant fifth place in Qatar. And completing that third row of the grid, Andrea Dovizioso riding the Repsol Honda. Great ride by him in Qatar, you remember, 3 weeks ago. Big battle for Nicky Hayden. He pushed Nicky Hayden off the podium. Andrea Dovizioso finishing in third place. Not a great record at Jerez. In his two MotoGP appearances, he has been eighth both times. Good qualifying also for almost the forgotten man of MotoGP, Marco Melandri. He was third here in 2005. Fifth here last year riding that Hayati Kawasaki. Only 13th in Qatar. His confidence has taken a bit of a bashing, but he looked very much more like the old Marco Melandri in practice and qualifying. Alongside him on that fourth row of the grid is the veteran Loris Caparossi, 34 years old now. His 21st Grand Prix appearance here in Jerez. And he won the race here for Ducati in 2006 and also put the Suzuki in fourth place in the race, the best ever position by Suzuki in Jerez. So Loris Caparossi determined to carry on Grand Prix racing.
Nick, I'm down on the grid now. Hiroshi Oyama has got his race face on. We're just going to grab a quick word with Tom Jojic, his crew chief in the Interwetten team. Tom, every time Hiroshi goes out, there seems to be some improvement. You know, but what's the expectation for the race today?
I think today he can make better result than Qatar. We made a good step this morning. He was really happy with the bike. We made another little step here for the race because you don't want to take a big risk in the race. So just some really small fine-tuning. And our target is to be the best rider of the guys that aren't at the very front of this pack. The top four are hard to beat, but we should be able to get in amongst the other guys fighting from 5th to 10th.
Thanks for that, Tom, and good luck.
Yeah, Hiroshi Yama has qualified 12th fastest, and Hiroshi Yama won the 250cc race here last year. Another former Jerez winner is Alvaro Bautista, riding the Suzuki. He's qualified 13th fastest. He won the 125cc race here previously. Crashed out in Qatar, so we want to put that right. Alongside him, his old sparring partner from the 250cc class, Hector Barbera. Not great results here in Jerez. Third in the 125s in 2004, 12th in Qatar. So Hector Barbera, like Alvaro Bautista alongside him, and Hiroshi Oyama just in front of them, learning their trade after coming from the 250s. Alicia Spargaro crashed out in Qatar, and as we heard from Ian, he is taking the soft tyre option, taking a bit of a gamble. He's had, without giving too much away, a good day for the family with his younger brother, Paul, having a very good 125cc race. Alicia Spargaro now wants to start scoring some points from the Pramac Ducati team. They came pointless away from Qatar. Down to the sixth row of the grid, Marco Simicelli, a former 250cc world champion, the second of those Gresini Honda riders. Double winner here in the 125cc class in Jerez. In the wet and the dry, remember, third in the race last year, only 11th in Qatar. A lot of work to do for Marco Simicelli in MotoGP, but surely he will get there. Alongside him, completing the rear of the field. It's Amika Kallio, a former 250cc winner here on the KTM just a couple of years ago. He also crashed out in Qatar on that Pramac Ducati. So both him and Aleix Espargaró starts in 15th place, desperate to score some points for the Italian team, the Ducati machinery. No better place to be in Europe, I can tell you, this afternoon. It's Jerez, it's the Spanish Grand Prix, and the MotoGP race about to start. And if they're anything like as good as the 125 and the Moto2, you are in for a treat. And look at that motorcycle park, just down to the right of the picture. Motorcycles parked everywhere. We will wait the official crowd, but I would imagine last year it was around the 125, 130,000 mark. Very much as big this time round. And they've come for lots of reasons, but the main reason is to watch MotoGP at the Jerez circuit. What a front row we've got. Casey Stoner, the former world champion. Valentino Rossi starting from the second row of the grid in fourth place, but he won the race here last year. He leads the world championship after winning in Qatar. Five minutes to go before the start of the race. Safety car on its way up towards turn one. And as often happens in a big sporting event and with a massive crowd, there's just a lull now. Everybody's just anticipating what is about to happen. It's a long race, 27 laps in the difficult conditions. A little bit cooler, as Ian was telling us, than it was in qualifying yesterday afternoon. But it's a punishing circuit.
And it's actually cooling down even more now, Nick. We've got some cloud cover over the circuit, hiding the sun, which was baking down onto this circuit for the previous two races. Conditions couldn't be more ideal for this MotoGP race.
Valentino Rossi, Jerry Burgess, is a long-established crew chief. Wish each other luck. Now come back onto the front row of the grid. Danny Pedrosa, former winner here in both the 250 and the MotoGP classes. So this is the front row. It's the Australian Casey Stoner, desperate to do well after that crash in Qatar, after he dominated practice and qualifying. Jorge Lorenzo, former double 250cc winner here, second in the Qatar race. How he loved to win in front of the Spanish crowd after crashing out from pole position last season. But in pole position, his 14th pole in the MotoGP class, Danny Pedrosa, winner of the race here in 2008, former 250cc winner here, out to make out for a bad start in Qatar when he finished in 7th place. MotoGP at Jerez starts in 3 minutes' time. Twenty-seven laps of the Jerez circuit. Valentino Rossi holds the circuit record of 139.818. And the race time from last year, of course. Front row, we've already seen them. Danny Pedrosa, Jorge Lorenzo, and Casey Stoner. Whoa, mouth-watering.
Road two is Valentino Rossi, Nicky Hayden, Randy Depunier. Sorry, Ian.
Yeah, I was just going to break in there. I've been asked a couple of times my prediction for this race, but I'm rubbish at this, so I'm down here in pit lane with their former 500cc world champion, Kevin Schwantz, and I'm going to put him on the spot. He knows a little bit about bike racing. Give me your top three today, Kevin.
Well, I think the 99 and the 26 are going to fight it out for the top. I don't know where the 27 and the 46 are going to be, but I think the 11 and the 69 are going to be the surprises today.
Okay, now I'm going to have to go and work those numbers out now. And well, thanks very much.
Jorge Lorenzo, I think, will be in front of the
Ask him about number 34. Where is he going to be?
And the guys in the company box want to know where number 34 is going to be come the end of this race.
He did all he could in Japan last week on the Twitter Grand Prix, so I don't think he's even starting today. He's resting.
Great.
Okay, thanks, Kevin.
Great stuff from Kevin Schwantz there. He predicts a Jorge Lorenzo win, a battle with Danny Pedrosa as well. And he says a surprise for Hayden and Spies. I don't think that's going to be too far off the truth. I think it will be a humdinger that we have here once more in Jerez. We've had two great races earlier on, and we could have another great one for MotoGP with two Spaniards starting us off, and then the talent of Stoner and Rossi just behind them.
They're on their sighting lap. Look at the temperature, 27 degrees centigrade, a little bit cooler.
Yeah, than yesterday. Anyway, it was 50 degrees on track yesterday. It's 44, the surface temperature, 111 degrees Fahrenheit, that is.
Now towards the Zito Pons corner that brings them onto the back straight. Downhill drags them in towards the dry sack corner. We've seen plenty of incident down there already in the 125s and certainly in Moto 2. And I'm sure it's not going to be any different in MotoGP.
You'll see down there, perhaps you won't see it at the moment, there's a big line of cement dust there. That was due to a crash during the Moto 2 race. Just saw it there with Alex. Coming through. That was because of a crash in Moto 2 that streaked fuel or oil mixture anyway across the surface, and loads of bikes went down. Look at the attendance here in Jerez today. 122,000 fans in the Jerez circuit. It's going to be a fabulous race ahead.
Up towards where most of those fans are situated. What an occasion this is. Jerez MotoGP and the second round of the World Championship. The winner of that first round, Valentino Rossi, starting from the second row of the grid. Can he repeat his success?
Dani Pedrosa on board with the man who starts this race, though, in pole position in front of his home fans, 122,000. Brilliant. There's such a crackling atmosphere around this Jerez circuit. It's the place to be in Spain, the place to be in Europe at this moment in time. And Dani Pedrosa is the man in the limelight. He wasn't at all happy with his bike yesterday. Maybe happier with it during the race.
Remember the start he made in Qatar from the third row of the grid? Well, he's in pole position now. It's going to be fun and games up towards turn one. This is round two of the MotoGP World Championship. 122,000 fans here in Jerez in Spain. The red lights are on. Racing is underway.
Good start from Valentino Rossi on the second row. Also from Ben Spies on the third row. But down to turn one, predictably as ever, it's going to be Dani Pedrosa who leads. Rossi in second. Hayden in third. And now Nicky Hayden's going to try and take Rossi into turn two, is he? No, Nicky Hayden third. Lorenzo fourth. And Casey Stoner in fifth place.
No great surprise from Dani Pedrosa. What a start, though, by Nicky Hayden. Remember, he made a great start in Qatar as they ran these fast left-handers up towards the back straight for the first time, the Zito Pons corner.
Very difficult corner, this. It's slightly uphill. They can get a bit too hot in here sometimes. Lose the front quite easily as it gets light in there. Down the back straight they go for the first time. There's Loris Capirossi. He's been 11th position after that start. Not made any gains there.
Down towards the dry sack corner for the very first time. Casey Stoner on the brakes, trying to get up the inside of Jorge Lorenzo, not able to do so.
Great start that from Nicky Hayden, wasn't it? Just having a look down. Ben Spies up into sixth position, just tucked in behind Casey Stoner. Andrea Dovizioso in eighth spot. Randy Depugno, one of the big losers at the start, down in 10th.
Real good scrap going on already between Jorge Lorenzo and Casey Stoner. Casey Stoner won't want any sort of gap to open up. Valentino Rossi beautifully placed now. We'll just push. Dani Pedrosa had a bit of a moment, then he will start pushing him hard from behind. He's the master tactician, Valentino Rossi, at doing exactly that.
And a great start to these. A bit of a gap to Lorenzo, but don't worry, Lorenzo has got some brilliant pace around here. The sun seems to have gone in just slightly and just hidden behind the clouds somewhat. And that will just affect the track temperature. Maybe not as hot as it was yesterday. I wonder if that will just help them with time towards the end of the race. Hayden runs it wide in the turn 13. And a slight gap forward between himself and Valentino Rossi at the front. But it's Pedrosa who leads after lap one here in Jerez.
Yeah, mistake there by Nicky Hayden. Just pulls his men nearer to them. What a start again by Ben Spies. First time he saw the Jerez circuit, I think, on a racing bike, certainly, was on Friday afternoon. And here he is running with the top men already.
Yeah, he's only had 3 hours, 20 minutes out on this track, and he's already up in sixth position. He is becoming a revelation in MotoGP. He might not be dominating like he did in World Superbike, but he's certainly giving a few of the established order something to think about.
Valentino Rossi looking comfortable in second place. Remember, Valentino Rossi injured his shoulder in that motocross accident after the win in Qatar. Typical Valentino Rossi luck, can you say? Japan race cancelled as Casey Stoner gets up the inside of Jorge Lorenzo and sets after his teammate Nicky Hayden.
Which is what he did last year, if you remember. Stoner, surprisingly, was ahead of Lorenzo in the race last year. And Lorenzo having to chase him down and crashed out of the race. Lorenzo, who's on pole last year, maybe the favourite for this race here, but not quite up there at the moment, is he? Not quite got the pace. Dovizioso threw on speeds, just saw. Yeah, up into sixth position ahead of the Texan.
Yeah, there is Ben Spies. That's Marco Melandri's having a decent ride behind Ben Spies after a real couple of years of disappointment.
Yeah, he started from 10th on the grid. It's Colin Edwards who's gone backwards to 11th in the Pounier 2, down into 12th.
I think Rossi's probably happy with the situation at the moment. Pedrosa hasn't managed to get away, and Rossi knows he can push him very, very hard from behind, as he's done on so many occasions.
I wouldn't be too worried at the moment if I was Stoner or Lorenzo. Spies a little wide in that corner. Bit of a Jerez experience maybe there from Marco Melandri, but Spies gets out of the corner very well indeed. Fastest rider on the circuit, as you might expect, Danny Pedrosa by 2,000 ahead of Valentino Rossi. They're a second ahead of Nicky Hayden in third place.
Down towards, down through turn two. Now the succession of fast left-handers. This is where Mick Doohan crashed 11 years ago. And that was the end of his 500cc Grand Prix racing career. Fast and furious through here, but you've got to get it lined up right now for the Zito Pons right-hander, a bank right-hander that brings them onto the back straight.
You could see Pedrosa and Rossi just trying to pull away from Hayden. Still the gap at a second through the first split. Now the sun comes out once more. They head down the back straight, down towards the dry sack corner. And he's not getting anywhere near him at the moment, is he, Valentino Rossi? Pedrosa leading this one. And after all the problems he stated, there is under braking with that bike. Looks very solid at the moment, Danny Pedrosa. The gap between Rossi and Hayden, well, it was 3/10 on that last lap, but added to the 7/10 that were there before. It's a healthy gap at the moment. There's no way through for Stoner behind Hayden or Lorenzo. But I reckon their time will come as the fuel loads go down and the tyres bed in that little bit more and start to plateau. I reckon it will bunch up once again. The lap times were so close between the top six in terms of consistency that I expect we'll get the three factory teams, factory Hondas, factory Yamahas and factory Ducatis up at the front.
Remember Qatar 3 weeks ago, it was Danny Pedrosa that led in the early stages there, wasn't it?
Ben Spies has just been relegated by both Loris Capirossi and Marco Simoncelli. I just wonder if he was pushed wide at the dry sack corner or something.
Up over the start finish line they go. Long, long way to go.
We've got a crash here down at Gicardos. I can't quite see it is at the moment.
Well, across the line, it looks like it's Loris Capirossi. It is. The Italian has crashed out. He was in eighth position and crashes out of the race and he walks away from that one. Disappointment for the Italian veteran.
Yeah, his 21st Grand Prix appearance here of Loris Capirossi. He won the race here for Ducati in 2006. Down at turn 13, going on, there's been some people down there in the last few years.
Just having a look at terms of lap times. Three riders in the 139s. Pedrosa, Rossi, not Nicky Hayden, but Casey Stoner, who started to up the pace slightly and is closing in on his teammate now. Will he be able to tack down the straight? No. Hayden looks so good coming through Zito Pons corner and down that back straight.
Still Pedrosa leads the way. Wasn't happy after qualifying in first place yesterday. Gavin had to interview him, full of beans, and he told him he wasn't happy at all. The pole position counted for nothing, despite it was in front of his Spanish fans. And Jorge Lorenzo will buy this time, but he's going to have to start making a move soon, isn't he?
I don't know. Remember his race in Qatar? He was in fifth, sixth place for a long time in that race. Just in the last few laps, he's got to pick off everyone.
I think he wants to win this one, don't you?
He'll be desperate to win this one. And with Pedrosa and Rossi away like this, I won't be happy at all with how things are panning out at the moment.
Well, it's good to see Danny Pedrosa riding a race here at the front. Seventh in Qatar, at a desperate pre-season testing time with the bike, trying to find some more stability under braking in particular for the Honda. They've stiffened up the frame. There is a test here tomorrow, and they say there's some new frames for him to test. But he's doing a really good job at the front as it stands at the moment.
I think Hiroshi Aoyama and Aleix Espargaró have both run off track. They're now 14 seconds behind Alvaro Bautista. So I wonder where that was for the Japanese rider. That was on the last lap that they really just lost touch with the Suzuki rider, Bautista.
Further down the field, Marco Melandri in seventh. Marco Simoncelli eighth. There we are. Ben Spies in ninth place. Just behind him is his teammate, Colin Edwards.
Yeah, he's in 10th. Pounier in 11th. And there's Mika Kallio in 12th. He's not been that great in practice or qualifying, but showing that when it comes to racing, he knows his way around this track. A former winner here, if I'm not mistaken, in 250 in about 2008.
He won it in the 250s in 2008. bad start, wasn't it, by Randy Depunier from the second row of the grid.
He won here when Bautista and Simoncelli took each other out after Bautista's
on the last lap,
wasn't it?
That's right, the very last
Jorge
lap
Jorge Lorenzo
of the
is closing right in on Casey Stoner, and I think he might have just got through on the Australian. Looks to me like
yes,
Lorenzo
has.
Is through and up into fourth position, past the Aussie. So Lorenzo has got... Stoner was losing touch on his teammate, Nicky Hayden. He was so good out of the box here when he had the... In fact, his second fastest lap of the weekend came on his fourth lap on Friday afternoon. Since then, in free practice on Saturday morning, and in qualifying yesterday, only managed one lap that was quicker than that, and even then by only 7 thousandths. So they said they had to go right back. Although he felt confident after that first practice, he wasn't so confident after qualifying.
Nicky Hayden, big, big crash for the former world champion on Saturday morning. 130 miles an hour, I think, was it on the telemetry. He did well to walk away from that one. Look out also for Andrea Dovizioso. Andrea Dovizioso beginning to close on that leading group, currently running in sixth place. Ben Spies ninth, Colin Edwards in tenth spot.
Down to turn two, it's still Pedrosa leading from Rossi in second place. The gap back to Hayden, 1.6 seconds. And then it's a further 0.9 back to Jorge Lorenzo. Casey Stoner in fifth, Andrea Dovizioso in sixth place, Melandri in seventh, Simoncelli in eighth, Spies in ninth, and Colin Edwards in tenth.
So how long is Valentino Rossi going to let this run? Well, a little while yet. He doesn't want Danny Pedrosa to get away. He hasn't got away, but I've got to say, Pedrosa's done a really good job at the front. I thought he wouldn't be at the front for this long.
Well, after all the problems he's talked about and all the issues they had in Qatar, I have to agree with you there. But Pedrosa is leading from Rossi in second spot. Edwards is up into ninth now, past Randy Depunia and Ben Spies. Ben Spies having a few problems in this race. It's partly surprising when he only first saw this, this track this weekend.
This is Alicia Spargaro, he was using soft tyres. Now,
he's got
soft rear. I wonder if he's decided that whatever it is, his race is over.
So it's Pedrosa leading by 0.4 now from Nicky Hayden, who's 2 seconds now behind Valentino Rossi. Lorenzo, though, is 0.8 down on Hayden, not making too much progress. Brilliant stuff yet again from Nicky Hayden after a huge crash, as Nick said yesterday. 130 miles per hour, that crash for Hayden. Lorenzo is closing slowly. Stoner, 0.6 behind Lorenzo. It's very, very even in terms of lap times, and that's why it's just spaced out slightly, because they can't make up anything on each other.
Certainly can't, and Dovizioso also closing up on Stoner.
And just quick update from Lawrence Caparossi. He said, rider error, pushing too hard into turn 13, lost the front, out he went. And Aleix Espargaró has pulled in because he's lost the rear brake lever off the right-hand side of his bike after crashing.
We didn't see the crash, but we saw him walk away back into the pits and
say
the race is over.
At the same time,
Yeah. Valentino Rossi chasing his seventh Premier Class victory here. Danny Pedrosa, the winner of the race here in 2008, and also a former 250cc winner.
Yeah, rear brake, sometimes some riders in the past haven't really used it that much, but sometimes riders do, so they want to take some of the weight off the front, that kind of thing, going into the corners. And more recently they've started employing it, especially Casey Stoner, who likes to use it a lot to help him around the corners.
Then Nicky Hayden's going to have a fight very, very hard to hang on to that third place, because Lorenzo urged on by the crowd. You also got to say he's looked very, very impressive during practice in particular, when he got in a lot of laps, a lot of fast laps on the race tyres. And Lorenzo, as seems his want a little bit at the moment, takes time to really settle into things, but he really is on the charge now. As we ride with Rossi, that's Pedrosa in front of him.
Yeah, Pedrosa's pulling away at the moment. 0.6, he leads Valentino Rossi by...
He's done it before, hasn't he?
He's done it before here as well. Remember last year he actually had a big lead, and then Rossi closed it down over the latter stages and went past him quite comfortably. Valentino Rossi, you would have said, was the least likely of the top four to finish on the podium today, but he always finds something. He's always got something in reserve. I had a few people say to me, oh, he's 14th in their warm-up. Anything you think there? And I was like, no, he's fine. I'm sure he'll find something in there. It's
just
relaxing,
doesn't
want to
hurt
his shoulder anymore. No.
And this is, at the moment, the classic Valentino Rossi's situation. He'd like to be a little bit closer, but he'll push and push and push against Danny Pedrosa. And I think, as always, the situation is if Danny Pedrosa can fight back and Rossi actually gets there. Often he can't, but he may prove us wrong today. As Nicky Hayden's going to have the fight mighty hard to hold off this man, Jorge Lorenzo.
On board with Lorenzo at the start of the race, and you can see our Valentino Rossi on the outside. There's Nicky Hayden. What a start he made to the race. Up into third straight away was Hayden, and that's really decided the race at the moment, hasn't it? With those three in those positions, Pedrosa, Rossi, Hayden. Hayden is now 2.4 down on Rossi, and Lorenzo is closing a 10th now every single sector. And soon, Jorge Lorenzo will be attacking Nicky Hayden. The question is, can Hayden hold him off? Can he fight back?
Still a long, long way to go. 19 and a half laps of this red circuit. Round two of the MotoGP World Championship. Official attendance here today, 122,000. And I'm sad to say, apart from a good few American servicemen from the local base down at Rota, we'll be cheering Jorge Lorenzo in this particular battle.
It's very intriguing, actually, the lap times, especially for Casey Stoner. He's down in the 140.8s at the moment, and I know he had a couple of problems. I know he wasn't particularly happy with the setup, but he was consistently setting those lap times, wasn't he, on Friday afternoon. Very similar conditions to now, and it's just intrigued me that he hasn't been able to keep the faster laps up and keep with Jorge Lorenzo the sort of lap times he was setting.
Lorenzo really closing up on Nicky Hayden, but Hayden's not going to make life easy for him through turn one, down towards turn two. Will he be close enough? If he's close enough, he'll probably have a go of him in the dry sack corner, which is down at the end of the back straight. This is through the two fast left handers that bring them up to the Zito Pons corner that brings him onto that.
And just to break in there, I can tell you that Ben Spies is out of the race as well. The Texans into pit lane, engine off. And he's parking that M1 Yamaha in the box.
Yeah, I've just seen him dropping down the order on that last lap, and he's obviously something terminal there for Ben Spies. Let's hope it's not an engine problem, because, of course, they only have a limited six engines for the entire season. And with two races down, you wouldn't want to be already losing one of your engines. I'm sure they'll be looking straight in. Tom House with his crew chief will be having a good look at Ben Spies' Yamaha and just trying to find out what went wrong.
The battle still rages for third place, and Nicky Hayden's not going to give it up without a big, big fight. But Lorenzo's now getting close enough to try and outbreak him somewhere, and Hayden's going to make life very difficult. It's great to see Nicky Hayden back riding like this.
And he's actually closing in on Rossi on this lap, is Nicky Hayden. Just took a tenth out of the time of the reigning world champion. But Lorenzo is closing even further on him. So let's have a look down at Decardos. Is there any room for Lorenzo through here? He's going to have a look at the inside line, but no. Hayden looks very good out of the corner, something that this Ducati's been designed for now, hasn't it? It's come a lot better out of the corners. A lot, the delivery of the power is supposed to help them drive out of those corners much, much better.
This is the battle for third place. Pedrosa still leads the way at the front, just over 1 second advantage over Valentino Rossi. And Lorenzo really wants to get close through here. He's going to have a go at him at the dry sack corner.
A bit wider there for Nicky Hayden. That takes a bit more out of the of turn three there. You can see Lorenzo just not too stable going into turn one.
I don't think he's going to be quite close enough. This is the Zito Pons corner that brings him onto the back straight.
Depends on the power, and usually that Ducati can lay it down a little bit better at the end of the straight than the Yamaha. Here comes Lorenzo, though, and here comes Nicky Hayden on the brakes, actually. Well done to Nicky Hayden, holding off the first attack from Lorenzo. Runs it a little bit wide now.
Wide.
On exit, oh, Lorenzo parked that bike in right in Hayden's path, didn't he, on the exit of that corner. It's a perfectly fine manoeuvre that was, wasn't it, from Jorge Lorenzo. Hayden tried everything he could on the brakes, just ran it a little bit deep inside the dry sack corner, and Lorenzo took the inside line and took him on the exit. Can Hayden fight back is the big question.
Well, he's made big, big steps this year, Nicky Hayden, with Ducati. The next step would be fighting back now against Jorge Lorenzo, wouldn't it?
Well, it's something he did last week against Andrea Dovizioso, remember? And so we know he is capable of doing that. We've seen it in the past, of course. At the front, Dani Pedrosa pulling away a second now on Dani Pedrosa. And would you say that Lorenzo is the only real threat to him here? Or is Lorenzo just too far away now already?
I think Lorenzo's the big threat. Sad, sad news, though. Ben Spies out of the race here in Jerez. But it's Pedrosa that leads the way.
And I can tell you that Ben Spies is out of the race because of a tyre problem. He lost all grip from the rear tyre.
Wow.
Interesting. Very interesting indeed. Especially considering Casey Stoner's travails at the moment. Nicky Hayden's lap time that time round, but he was sort of barged wide, wasn't he, a little bit by Jorge Lorenzo, who's slightly slower. The gap from Lorenzo to Rossi now, 2.7 seconds more or less. Rossi to Pedrosa, 1.1 to Pedrosa, is pulling away, and Lorenzo isn't closing by that much. It's very similar lap time to Dani Pedrosa.
This is Dani Pedrosa at his best, getting out at the front and just laying down lap after lap after lap. Can Valentino Rossi fight back? On many, many occasions he has, but sometimes when Pedrosa gets out at the front like this, nobody can catch him. And you've got to say, after all the disappointments in Qatar, it would be a truly remarkable result if he went on to win this race. But Rossi gets better and better as the fuel load gets lighter and lighter.
The gap's just gone out to 1.5 seconds. Lorenzo is closing in on Rossi, and Nicky Hayden's not too far behind. I reckon Rossi could start feeling it now. Who knows what's going to happen with these sides? We've already heard Ben Spee's had a problem that sent him out of the race. Pedrosa very wide in that final corner there.
Gavin, I'm down here now. It looks like it was a front tyre problem for Ben Spee's, but I'm with Hervé Poltrol. Hervé, can you tell us a little bit more about the problem?
Yeah, we don't know too much at the moment, but for sure, front tyre, we didn't have any problem for the whole weekend, and Ben said after two or three laps, it was... no grip, and it was feeling like a flat tire. It wasn't flat, we check the pressure, we check the pressure. It's perfect, but there was no way it could carry on, so we have to see what's happening. It's very weird.
Okay, commiserations, Hervé, but thanks.
Great battle going on between the San Carlo Honda Grassini riders. First, Simoncelli took Malandri at turn one, then Malandri straight back at him at turn two. Brilliant battle this for seventh place. And this would be a great boon for the Grassini team as well, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would. Just what they both need, actually. They both started the pre-season testing and even the race in Qatar in pretty low spirits. They really are fighting out. Both of them very good 250cc riders. And Marco Simoncelli, former double winner here in the 125cc class. Thoroughly enjoying it. Randy De Puigne watching it from a distance at the moment, but closing on them as they battle it out between themselves.
He's getting stronger as the race goes on, Randy De Puigne. And he's starting to close in on this duo now. Just at the front, just having a look at who's closing in on who. Hayden slightly on Lorenzo. Stoner on that last lap slightly on Hayden as well. And Lorenzo slightly on Valentino Rossi.
This is a fabulous race between Marco Simoncelli and Marco Malandri. And Randy De Puigne, as you rightly say, now closing up all the time on them. But Ben Spies, it appears that it was a front tyre problem then. Very unusual. No such problems during practice or qualifying. And that's cruel, cruel luck for him. But again, I think he's showed enough just what he's made of.
Yeah, Stoner there, that lap closing a 10th on Hayden. Meanwhile, Lorenzo Rossi, similar lap times, both closing a 10th on Pedrosa. But still, 1.4 between Pedrosa and Rossi, 2.2 between Lorenzo and Rossi. Again, Marco Malandri up on the inside of Marco Simoncelli, and Randy De Puigne in close attendance. These three satellite Honda machines, all very evenly matched at the moment. Very fierce battling going on between the team, the two Marcos.
Two Italians, two Marcos, and the Frenchman on the LCR team riding for an Italian team. Battle for seventh place. Cracking battle it is as well. 14 and a half laps to go here. The second round of the MotoGP World Championship. Dani Pedrosa still leads the way. Rossi and Lorenzo, first and second in Qatar, now trying to close up on the man at the front. Nicky Hayden trying to stay with the two Yamahas in fourth place. Casey Stoner, 5. Andrea Dovizioso in sixth place. And this is the battle for seven.
Such tight margins in MotoGP now. Just a tenth here and a tenth there can amount to, as we've seen, a second and a half, with still 14 and a half laps remaining between Pedrosa and Rossi. Lorenzo has closed 3/10 on that last split on Valentino Rossi. That's where he's strongest, in that third sector, and where Valentino Rossi is actually probably the weakest.
There is no doubt this is where Dani Pedrosa is at his best, as in when he can get out in front. Seems to concentrate so, so hard and likes to ride a race almost against the clock than against any opponent. As if people can get up alongside him and rough him up a bit, that sometimes he's not so good. But he's riding a brilliant race.
Okay,
at the
Lorenzo
front
has taken half a second out of Rossi's time on that lap. Nicky Hayden's taken a couple of tenths out of Rossi's time, but none out of Lorenzo. And Stoner still 2 seconds behind Hayden. He's struggling today. Andrea Dovizioso in turn is a second behind Casey Stoner, quite spread out, and then it's 8.8 seconds back to that battle between the two Marcos and Randy De Puigne. And Mika Kallio actually has joined that battle.
Yeah, right? Who's done really well.
Yeah, he's ahead of Colin Edwards in 10th.
Who's crashed out in Qatar. Not had the best of the starts of the season. Former 250cc winner, doing a good job. In some ways, you say it's easy to lead a race the way Danny Pedrosa is because you're pumped up and you're leading, but sometimes you want a little bit of action around you just to keep you on your mettle, don't you?
Yeah, it's only 1.6 seconds, and we know once the tyres go, anything could happen. I'm just wondering in terms of the temperature. It looks like the sun's gone in. It's a bit cloudy out there. Temperature's dropping all the time. Interesting what will happen at the end of this race. So tight between the front riders, but it looks like such a big gap on track. There's 1.3 between Pedrosa and Rossi now, 1.8 between Rossi and Lorenzo, and 1.8 between Lorenzo and Hayden.
Yeah, a bit spaced out at the moment, but I don't think that will remain, as Gavin says, when the tyres start going off. Jorge Lorenzo's worked hard to get past Nicky Hayden. Valentino Rossi coming into his probably his best part of the race just coming up now. Danny Pedrosa hang in there. Well, the next 13 laps, we will find out. It would be a remarkable recovery after his disappointment in Qatar. And Rossi, with all his problems, shoulder injuries and what have you, he'll want to win the race, but picking up 20 or even 16 points won't be the end of the world for him.
Aleix Espargaró, who did go back out on track, is back in the pits now. And just wonder what the problem is for him there. I suppose they can use it more like a test
session.
Dead
right, they can, yeah. Yeah, get some track time out there, even if he's not going to score any World Championship points.
So on that last lap, Valentino Rossi took 0.4 out of Danny Pedrosa, and Lorenzo matched his lap time almost. So still some fight in this race yet from the Yamaha riders, and I wouldn't be surprised to see them gradually closing down. Still a long, long way to go, 12 and a half laps.
Classic Arez picture, the real wheel hopping off the ground. Valentino Rossi's right foot going out just to stabilise the Yamaha as he dives into turn one. It could be very, very close this one. Rossi is closing, and of course he's bringing Lorenzo along with him.
Danny Depunier has got past Marco Simoncelli and up into eighth position, so the Frenchman on the move, but between himself and Melandri, there's nothing to choose. Less than a tenth between the three of them.
Nicky Hayden, fourth in Qatar, running fourth at the moment. Looks pretty safe in fourth place, but probably not quite got the pace now to reach those men in front of him.
Yeah, 2 seconds now between himself and Lorenzo. Here comes Danny Pedrosa across the line. When he does do that, there'll be 12 laps remaining in this race, and it is a little bit duller out there, isn't it, now?
It's funny you should say that, Gav. I've just come out to the back of the pit lane, and the wind has picked up considerably. And there's some ominous dark clouds heading towards the circuit.
No.
Oh.
No. It's almost summer here. It's been 30 degrees Celsius all week. And then come to the race and there's some clouds there. Well, let's hope it holds off for this race. Look at Mika Kallio there. Through on Randy Depunier. It really is a very good battle going on behind Marco Melandri. Melandri's in seventh. And then it's Simoncelli, Kallio and Depunier. Just with Colin Edwards, a spectator at the moment.
Yeah, the back of that group, that familiar style from the former World Superbike champion. His teammate out of the race with a front tyre problem, Ben Spies. This is a cracking race for seventh place. But I just have got the feeling with 11 and a half laps to go, it's going to close right up at the front. And then, can Rossi get past Pedrosa? Yeah, may Lorenzo. But then what happens between the two Yamahas when they get
there? Well, once they start battling at the front, that will bring Lorenzo into the game as well. That's the thing. Oh, look at this from Kallio. And Depunier tried around the outside there, didn't he? A great stuff from Mika Kallio. Now up into eighth position from last on the grid. A great ride by the Flying Finn.
Yeah, good to see for the Pramac Ducati team. Miserable time for them in Qatar. Both the riders crashing out. But Kallio, a wealth of experience at this circuit, a winner in the 250cc class. Did well last year on his MotoGP debut season. Colin Edwards, disappointing at the moment, down in 11th place. After a really good testing for Colin Edwards, it's not quite gone right, has it, for him in Qatar or here?
Well, he's struggled just a little bit at the start of this season, hasn't he, Colin Edwards? Wonder if something to do with the engines and how they've been detuned, that kind of thing, to make sure they last, I don't know. Speculation all the way along. Right, at the front, Pedrosa, Rossi, Lorenzo still. 1.4 between Pedrosa and Rossi. 1.6 now back to Lorenzo. So Lorenzo picking up time on Valentino Rossi in second place.
I tell you, and I haven't seen Danny Pedrosa's a ride as well as this for a long, long time. This is Pedrosa at his absolute best. If he wins this race, this is going to do him and Honda's confidence so, so much good.
It's exactly the race he likes, just out there at the front. He's dominated him from the start. He got the whole shot into the first corner. Nothing anyone like Rossi or Lorenzo can do, but there's still 10 and a half laps remaining, and it's all still to play for, definitely. Into the stadium section one more time from Danny Pedrosa into the left-hander of Jorge Martínez Aspar corner. Pedrosa and Lorenzo file behind him, and they are picking up a 10th here, a 10th there, but Pedrosa's able to eke out another 10th.
That's right. Visually, you look and you think, they're closing, and then suddenly, no, he's riding as well as I've seen him ride for a long, long time, Danny Pedrosa. He's much maligned in many ways, isn't he? And but he is an absolute top-class Grand Prix rider. And if he wins this one, it's going to do him and Honda so, so much good. The Yamaha duo try to close. They're at it again. This is Marco Simoncelli and Randy Depunier. It's the battle for eighth. I think Calio's got up to seventh,
has he? I think Depunier just got back past him as well, though, actually.
Sorry, yeah, Melandri really in seventh. Right. Yeah, really terrific.
I'm not mistaken, that looked like Javier Garcia Vico on the right, motocrosser.
Yeah.
Spanish motocross, I think he's former world champion.
There's Colin Edwards. That's the second of the Suzuki's, the only one left in the race. That's Alvaro Bautista, currently running in 12th place. His teammate, Loris Caparotti, crashing out turn 13 to Carlos Corona early in the race. His verdict, rider error.
Yeah, and Bautista is a slow learning process, isn't it? It's going to take a while, as it is for Hector Barber just behind him. Hector Barber was really quick out of the garage as well on Friday, just like Casey Stoner, wasn't he? He was up in the top six on Friday afternoon, but as everyone else progressed, he hasn't made that step forward that everyone else has. There's Jorge Martínez Aspar, who is manager for that team, and the Moto2 and 125 teams that he runs in this championship. Gives a lot back to this paddock, Aspar, after his five world championships, I believe it is.
Yeah, 80s and 125s, wasn't it? The old 80cc class.
He's obviously a big hand behind that Valencia circuit as well.
Yep.
But had a corner named after him here at Jerez earlier on this weekend.
Well, there's the situation in picture. This is Jorge Lorenzo in third place. In front of him, Valentino Rossi, his teammate. But the man that's led from the start, Danny Pedrosa.
Fastest man on the circuit at the moment is Lorenzo. He is closing in. Look at that, every single lap.
Yeah.
10th. Two tenths, another tenth here, and that's the one we've got to watch.
But it's nine laps left, and they go under the flying saucer, up towards turn one.
Yeah, another tenth. Lorenzo has just set his personal best lap of the race so far. Is it going to be enough, though? A tenth here and a tenth there, I don't think so. He needs bigger jumps. He needs the tyres to start going off for the riders in front of him.
Nicky Hayden still running a rather lonely fourth place now, as is Casey Stoner, the Ducati's fourth and fifth. Andrea Dovizioso also a bit lonely in sixth place. But behind them, it's been a fantastic scrap for seventh place.
You know, this must be one of the first times that Nicky Hayden has outridden, when I say that, is finished the race in the same race, a very level playing field as Casey Stoner, and finished ahead of the Australian. And that will be a big boost to him and his confidence for the rest of the year.
Rossi and Lorenzo continue their chase of Pedrosa at the front. Yeah, Lorenzo just pulling back, what, 0.2 of a second there on Valentino Rossi. But is it going to be enough with 8.5 laps to go? Lorenzo looked very, very impressive in practice on race cards in qualifying, put in his usual enormous number of laps. But again, he was very quick, wasn't he, on the Saturday morning in slightly cooler conditions.
Just Lorenzo in that last split, down to 0.9 now. It's under a second. So he's taken 0.4 already on this lap. Jorge Lorenzo is starting to motor, and he's coming back into this race just as he did in Qatar 3 weeks ago.
2002, Jorge Lorenzo arrived at this circuit for his first Grand Prix. He was 14. They wouldn't let him ride on the Saturday, the Friday. They had to wait till the Saturday when he was 15 to let him ride in the 125cc race. He's won a couple of 250cc races here since then, and he is revered by the fans here.
Yeah, he celebrates his birthday on Tuesday, Jorge Lorenzo, and currently he's 22, so you can work that one out.
Even I can with my problem with mathematics. And again, 23.
That last lap, Jorge Lorenzo, the 23-year-old on Tuesday, just set his fastest lap of the race. He really is starting to move along now. Rossi is slowing down slightly at half a second on that last lap. It's getting close, and soon Lorenzo will be close enough to have a go. Then will he be able to close down Dani Pedrosa? The gap from Pedrosa to Lorenzo, 2.5 seconds.
I don't think he will. I think Dani Pedrosa has ridden an absolutely brilliant race at the front.
Think what you like. You'll find out in the next 7.5 laps.
Yeah, 7.5 to go. I'm amazed, Dani Pedrosa, after the Qatar race for him when he seems so out of sorts.
There's Ago.
15 times world champion. Giacomo Agostini watches on. He'd love to be out there, wouldn't he?
Doesn't need to know about how many world championships. He's just a MotoGP legend, and that's true.
Is.
Had one of those earlier on with Kevin Schwantz as well. They're all in. They all want to see this battle between the top riders in the world. Nicky Hayden's now 4.5 seconds behind Lorenzo, and Stoner 3.5 behind him. Dovizioso 1.5 behind him. So those positions look fairly settled. The big question is, these three on the podium, but in which order?
Yeah. Now, when he arrives at the back of Valentino Rossi, which he's going to do quite soon, how hard will Rossi fight against Jorge Lorenzo? Or may he say, you have a go at Pedrosa because I can't catch him? I don't know.
Oh, wide again from Valentino Rossi coming out of turn one. Lorenzo is closing all the time on his teammate. Surely a matter of time before Jorge Lorenzo is able to make a move on Valentino Rossi. And I can guarantee you, Rossi, he will not give up without a fight. There's so much rivalry, and he knows he's one of his big rivals for the championship.
And that is just going to help Dani Pedrosa, isn't it? It's all very well getting there, and he's almost there now.
Here we go. Cito Ponce corner down the back straight. Can Jorge Lorenzo get close to Valentino Rossi? Doesn't look like it. Rossi pulls away down the early part of the straight. Now on the inside, that big right leg comes out from Valentino Rossi, and there's no way through for Jorge Lorenzo.
He may have to wait for another lap, even to have a nibble at him. So this is where Nicky Hayden crashed on a practice on Saturday morning's very fast left-hander. Second left-hander coming up now before they come into the succession of right-handers, starting with the handheld in the 8-0 corner. He may be close enough, he can get a bit closer, to have a go at him at turn 13. But as Sete Gibernau found out, taking Rossi at turn 13 is not the best place to try it.
But Lorenzo is so strong in this section of track, isn't he? Around those left-handers, that tries. That closes right up on Rossi now. Now through fast right-hander of Crivier corner. Next up, it's going to be Ferrari corner. And then the final corner is Ducato's. Will he make a move? Lorenzo will do it in the next, well, the next lap. Surely he's got to have a go. Surely.
May even have a go up at turn one. Yeah, up the uphill right-hander. Difficult place to overtake. He's coming right up now into the slipstream of Valentino Rossi. Rossi in second place. And Jorge Lorenzo, here he comes. No way through at turn one for Lorenzo.
Yeah, Lorenzo thought about it. Rossi stuck the leg out, right? Well, like one of those sort of, I don't know, when you try to turn on a bike, you stick your arm out there. You just don't want anyone to go past. You want everyone to know where you are. And we knew Rossi was tipping it into that corner there. And I just wonder, they're not closing in on Pedrosa, so Lorenzo needs to make this stick sooner rather than later. Now maybe towards the dry sack corner. They're into Cito Ponce, and maybe at the bottom of the back straight we'll see something from Jorge Lorenzo. He's tight in behind him now. Here comes Jorge Lorenzo. Will we see a move from him at the end of the back straight? Here he comes.
Lorenzo into second place in front of Valentino Rossi. Now then, 5.5 laps to go. He's got past his teammate. Can he do anything about Dani Pedrosa at the front? We are going to find out in about the next lap if there's any chance of this race lead changing. Rossi tries to fight back, but I think Rossi is having problems. He's going to have to settle for third place. All eyes now focus on Jorge Lorenzo. Can he catch that man in the front from the helicopter shot, Dani Pedrosa?
2 seconds the gap between Pedrosa and Lorenzo. Just over 5 laps remaining in this race. Nothing Rossi could do about that one. Dejection in the Rossi side of the garage. He won the first race, but this would flip things on its head, wouldn't it? Lorenzo was second in that first race, and there'd be a point between them if things stayed the same towards the end of the race. Spanish fans are loving this one. It's been a brilliant day for them here, and it's got even better. But Pedrosa, well, he's not being caught at the moment. 2 seconds the gap between himself and Lorenzo.
That's keeping it really legal, isn't it? 2 seconds. keeps it around 2 seconds, even 1.5 seconds. Fabulous stuff from Danny Pedrosa.
All this while, just looking further down the order, Marco Simoncelli still on Callio for 8. That was the move from Jorge Lorenzo. We held our breath, didn't we? Just to see what was going to happen. Didn't want to get ahead of ourselves. And Lorenzo stuck it through, didn't run it wide on exit, which is the main thing.
Danny Pedrosa, 5 laps to go for the Honda rider up into turn one. Lorenzo in second place. Is he closing him down in any way?
A tenth in the
not
first
enough.
Sector. Yeah, he's pushing very, very hard to do it though, isn't he? That last lap, that's not enough there. He really needs something drastic to happen with Pedrosa's bike, but it seems to be working ideal. Although he'll complain about it, Danny Pedrosa, that bike looks as though it's working very, very well here in Jerez. And as Jorge Lorenzo said after free practice, you just always know that Pedrosa is going to be strong at this circuit.
Lorenzo is giving it a really big shot here. He's giving it absolutely everything. But in the back of the mind, he remember last year, started this race in pole position and crashed out. Doesn't want to crash out. 20 points from the first race, 20 points from the second race will be a good reward as we go into Le Mans in 3 weeks' time for Lorenzo. Alberto Puig, a former winner here, the mentor of Danny Pedrosa, urges him on as he goes down the start and finish straight.
Well, half a second on that last lap, all of a sudden from Jorge Lorenzo. Pedrosa's just eased up slightly, and look what they're telling him. Lorenzo's 0.8 behind you. That wasn't the case at all. It was 1.5 across the line. It was 2 seconds the lap before. Have we still got something to happen here in the latter stages of this race?
Telling a few porky pies to get him going a bit faster at the front, aren't they? I don't know if it'll work or not, but Lorenzo...
Another tenth in the first split.
He's in the zone, Lorenzo, isn't he? Absolutely in Lorenzo Land zone.
And he wants to annex Jerez, doesn't he?
Yeah.
To Lorenzo Land after two disappointing years here, starting from pole. Let's have a look again at that move we saw from the helicopter from Jorge Lorenzo on Valentino Rossi.
Well, that's where he took over second place with Valentino Rossi. That's what the crowd thought about
There's
it.
There's the Lorenzo fans waving their Lorenzo's Land flag. Is he going to be able to plant his own flag in the gravel here? 1.4 the gap in the last split. The third split comes through in the next, just after the next of the right-handers in Nieto, into the stadium. The fans will be on their feet as they go through. You can hear the air horns going off now through that third split. Another tenth from Jorge Lorenzo. So he is closing slowly but surely.
Can Danny Pedrosa ride out the pressure? The pressure is now coming on the young Spaniard at the front.
Be interesting what they put out for him, doesn't
yeah.
it, on the pit board this time.
Surely no porky pies this time.
Yeah,
right?
They are. They put plus 0.6.
Of course they have. Of course they have. They like to play with his head and say, you've got to get a move on, Danny. He probably is pushing all he can anyway. But they're trying to say Lorenzo's right on your tail. Lorenzo just set his fastest lap of the race so far. It's down to a second. The gap between Pedrosa and Lorenzo with 3 laps remaining. Nicky Hayden still comfortably in fourth.
Nicky Hayden up into turn one. Great ride by Nicky Hayden, beating his teammate Casey Stoner, who's currently riding in fifth place. Not a great afternoon for Ducati, but they are racking in some world championship points.
Yeah, the first of the season for Stoner as well. He's never really got to grips with this circuit on the Ducati. After Friday said, I could maybe challenge for the victory. The gap between Pedrosa and Lorenzo down to 0.7 now. 2.5 laps remaining through the first split. It's 0.7 between the two Spaniards on board with Stoner in fifth spot.
2.5 laps to go. We ride with Casey
0.6
Stoner.
Through the second split. Sorry, Nick.
No, no problem at all. 2.5 laps to go. Casey Stoner in fifth place. His fifth place. And of course, Casey Stoner, that would be his first points of the season. Is a Roshi Oyama who won the 250cc race here last season, up into turn one, currently running in 14th place. Just over 2 laps remaining at the front, and that's the gap. Danny Pedrosa through the Ferrari corner. Through Alex Crevier corner, now through Ferrari.
That's Pellucchini. Now they're going to the two fast right-handers. The gap is under half a second now between Pedrosa and Lorenzo. We have a grandstand finish in the Spanish Grand Prix between two Spaniards. It's going to go down to the wire. Where will the pass happen? Will there be a pass? Can Pedrosa hand him off, hold him off, whatever? With 2 laps remaining when they cross the line, it's all still to play for.
How much have they taken out of their tyres? Actually catching up Danny Pedrosa and getting past him. 2 laps for Jorge Lorenzo to rule here in the race. Up at turn one.
0.3 now the gap between them, but that doesn't matter. He's right on Dani Pedrosa's tail now, and he surely will have a chance to go through. Pedrosa must be struggling with those tyres, struggling with the problems with the front end he's had on his Honda all year. And Jorge Lorenzo, early on in the race, is really biding his time, and here comes Lorenzo. Maybe a shot move in Sito Pons corner, or will it be down the end of the straight? Has he got the grunts on the Yamaha to match the Honda?
This is where he's going to try it. He's going to get out of here quick. Lazito Pons corner not close enough at the moment. Once they get a little bit closer before
here
they break for try attack. He's
he
on the brakes. Up the inside comes Jorge Lorenzo. Will he make it stick? Will Pedrosa run it wide? Pedrosa just hangs in there.
Oh,
no!
They almost touch. They almost touch on the exit from the corner. Lorenzo took the tight line, held his bike in there. Such bravery from the Mallorcan. But Pedrosa holds him off. There's going to be another chance, surely.
Could all end in tears. Who said Dani Pedrosa can't scrap it out at the front? And a rear end wiggle there from the Honda from Dani Pedrosa. Lorenzo's got to do it all over again.
This is going to be an amazing last lap with the fans all on their feet. Valentino Rossi 1.3 seconds behind is a spectator, but could pick up the pieces if there was any collision between these two. There almost was at turn six on that last lap at the end of the back straight. Now down into Ducato's. Is there a chance for a move? This was it. Lorenzo very, very tight. Just kept his bike in there. Wants to get the exit. Oh, and Lorenzo's tried it. That's Ducato's corner, and Pedrosa hangs him out to dry in the corner. Back to turn one this time. Is there another chance for Lorenzo? Brilliant stuff this is.
Into turn one, one lap to go here at Jerez, a classic Spanish Grand Prix between two great Spanish riders, both of them former world champions. They're at turn two, full marks to Pedrosa. He's fallen off two big efforts from Jorge Lorenzo. Lorenzo surely will have another go, either at Zito Pons as we ride with him, but surely down at Drysack.
Even if he has a go at Drysack, surely in the final corner there's going to be something going on. Is it going to be echoes of Doohan and Crivier? Is it going to be echoes of Rossi and Gibbonau in that final corner? Pedrosa and Lorenzo, the new breed, having a brilliant scrap here. On board with Lorenzo.
Here he comes, Jorge Lorenzo. Has he got up the inside on the brakes? Brakes, who's going to leave it later? No, Dani Pedrosa holds him off, runs him wide. Lorenzo takes the lead.
Pedrosa wide. Can Rossi get through? Because that's very wide from Dani Pedrosa. That's going to be the move that seals it from Jorge Lorenzo. He didn't even push Pedrosa. He just let him know he was there. Pedrosa knew he had to take the wider line and try and squirt it out of the corner. But it wasn't going to happen. Listen to the fans as they come into the stadium section for the final time.
Less than half a lap to go. They are going absolutely crazy here in Jerez. 122,000 Spanish fans are on their feet. What a ride by Lorenzo. He will take over the lead in the World Championship after two rounds if he just stays aboard the Yamaha. Two bends to go for the Mallorcan.
And he's going to push it very, very hard into this final corner. He'll think Pedrosa's there. Very tight line from Jorge Lorenzo, but he's done it. He's going to win the Spanish Grand Prix and make up for his disappointments over the last couple of years. Brilliant, brilliant riding from Lorenzo. Three riders across the line within a second. That's your podium, Lorenzo, Pedrosa, Rossi. Oh, and the two Haydens are very close. Without that bit of gravel there, maybe Stoner would have taken Hayden, but Hayden is fourth, Stoner is fifth. He'll be very disappointed, but racks his first points of the season.
Yeah, Nicky Hayden won the battle of the Ducatis, a lonely ride for Andrea Dovizioso coming into sixth place. Oh, celebration time, as you can imagine, with the Jorge Lorenzo side of the Yamaha garage.
What a ride this is from Mika Kallio as well, up into seventh from last on the grid, ahead of Marco Melandri in eighth, De Punier in ninth. Bautista's done well to get 10th there ahead of Simoncelli and Edwards. Hector Barbera in 13th, and Hiroshi Aoyama will cross the line in 14th. That has got to be one of his greatest, greatest wins. And a thumb up, actually, from Dani Pedrosa there.
Yeah, great ride by Pedrosa. In the end, I think there was nothing he could do. He fought back, didn't he, on two occasions, but it was almost inevitable that it was going to happen.
That was the move, and he just left the bike in there, and Dani Pedrosa tried to run it wide. You see, he tried to pull it round to squirt it out of the corner, but he couldn't. He didn't feel he had enough grip to be able to pull it round late in that corner and squirt out of turn six, and Lorenzo did it. And he, you know, in the early stages of the race, what do we say? He will come into his own in this race. By this time, he's done exactly that. He's passed Stoner, passed Hayden, passed Valentino Rossi, and in the end, made the pass that told on Dani Pedrosa.
Wow, what a Spanish Grand Prix. What a start to the MotoGP season. Qatar and a race like this. I've got to say, with five or six laps to go, I thought Pedrosa was going to win it. But Lorenzo, brilliant. I love the way that Pedrosa fought back against him. But it was almost inevitable, wasn't it?
This is the one we didn't see on the lap previously. Around the outside, that's his nickname, Paul Fuera. Jorge Lorenzo tried a very cheeky maneuver there, didn't he?
Turn 13, back into the start and finish.
Brilliant.
He'd have done exactly the same maneuver on the last lap.
He saw Pedrosa take such a tight inside line. He thought, right, you're going to come for that line. I'm going to try a cheeky one round the outside. And a great shake of the hands between Rossi and Pedrosa. They've got good mutual respect for each other. All the riders at the front of this championship do. And a wave to the crowd, but the plaudits will go out to Jorge Lorenzo after a brilliant, brilliant ride.
You think he'll milk it, or he'll just be very quiet?
He'll be calm. He won't stop the bike. He won't plant any flags anywhere, will he?
Or jump in the crowd over the fence?
Nothing like that.
No.
He might not. He won't be able to do any wheelies, though. They won't like that in terms of engine durability. No burnouts, that kind of... Drops the Spanish flag onto the turf, and now he's going to stop. And I think we might see another flag planted.
So do I. It could be like that one.
One of them, maybe.
Disappointing ride for Casey Stoner. Fifth place for the former world champion, beaten by his teammate Nicky Hayden.
I could be mistaken, but I think that could be the first time in a straight head-to-head. But maybe tyre problems, maybe issues for him. And there, we just missed it. But Jorge Lorenzo plants the Lorenzo's Land flag into the gravel. A big round of applause for the fans. They've helped him get there, and it's... I thought you said he wasn't going to do this, though.
I tell you what, he's absolutely shattered, isn't he, with effort. He can hardly climb up onto those tyres to wave to the crowd. He has put everything in.
This was the move that did it. Lorenzo showed him. Look, Pedrosa knows. He's seen the wheel there of Jorge Lorenzo. He knows, all right, I can't turn in, so I've got to run it a bit deeper, but he just can't get... The turn done, and a perfectly fine manoeuvre from Lorenzo. Look, Rossi will be disappointed with third. For much of that race, he's going to take second, but maybe, third was more than he might have hoped with that damaged shoulder or with Stoner ahead of him on the grid. Works so well in the race, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. It's good points for Valentino Rossi. And I think great for the championship to see Honda and Dani Pedrosa really back to top form. Alex Gravier, there he is talking to Dani Pedrosa, former winner here in the old 500cc class. And slowly and surely, Jorge Lorenzo will make his way back to Parc Fermé.
Roberto Puig on the left, and it's Dani's father on the right.
Oh, he's off again. Where's he going?
Where's he going now?
He jumped in there.
I've never seen anything like that. Brilliant stuff from Hawks. Send the lifeguards out. I hope he can swim. That is absolutely superb from Jorge Lorenzo.
Look. Hold up. Good crawl motion. He's in the lane.
That is genius.
That's probably going to cost him some money, but
maybe
I don't think he's going to be too well.
But who
can he get out? I don't know if he can get out now.
No, he's going to struggle. Look at them all trying to go in there. They're going to make a human chain to get him out.
Well, we thought this man is using the man that celebrates in style, but actually jumping in the lake in your leathers and helmet.
Get the scuba gear out for Jorge Lorenzo.
They can't get him out. Look, he can't get out.
There's no way out of it.
They've thrown in the life belts for him.
I was just down here in the Marlborough Ducati pit box with Nicky Hayden. Nicky, another good race, another fourth place. Happy with the performance today?
Well, I mean, you know, not fourth is not a disaster, but... You know, I really hope to been able to stay closer to him and put up a better fight. 9 seconds is quite a lot. I was quite confident for the race. I knew it would be extremely tough, but I thought we might be hanging in there a little bit better. But overall, you know, another solid weekend for us, and we're trying to build something here. So the team, the bike, everything was perfect. It was just really missing a couple tenths to really go with it. But hopefully we got some good data and some good learning from me.
You sound a bit disappointed, but your expectations are higher now, I guess.
Yeah, sure, things change quick, you know. I mean, I certainly know the pack that I got. You know, we were pretty fast this weekend, and I was hoping, like Qatar, you know, in the race, normally I always find a little something, and thought maybe it would be the case, but yeah, you know, I mean, if factory Marlboro Ducati rider. We're not supposed to jump up and down with fourth places now. But nonetheless, positive weekend for us, thanks to my team. I mean, like I said yesterday, they work like dogs this weekend and get to do it some more tomorrow because we got another day testing. And, you know, big thanks to those guys and my fans. And, yeah, not so bad. We'll take it, yeah.
Congratulations, Nicky.
I'm so
glad
Nicky Hayden, but that from Jorge Lorenzo. Get the scuba gear out.
Where have you been? I've been for a swim. Well done, Nicky Hayden. Great fourth place. Yeah, he did sound a little bit disappointed, and I'll tell you why, because his expectations are getting higher and higher.
Is it fair to say that Jorge Lorenzo was cruising today?
Crawling to victory. Oh, no, don't let's start those. Well, I can tell you now, it's going to be chaos down in Park Fermo. Tell him to towel down before we do the television interviews with him. We can't have a wet bloke in here, can we?
That's superb.
Yeah, brilliant.
Absolutely
and a
superb.
Brilliant ride by him.
It was. I reckon that's one of his best.
Ah, I'm sure. Certainly his best MotoGP ride, I think. We're waiting to see.
He's loving that, isn't he?
Another classic MotoGP race here at Arez. It throws up races like this all the time. We weren't let down, were we?
We won here in the 250s in 2006, 2007. A very special track for him. First Grand Prix was here in Jerez. And this is his first victory here, though, in MotoGP. We said he would milk it, didn't we?
Yeah, we said that we'd be jumping about. Even we didn't say he was going to jump in the lake, did we? With all his helmet and leathers, boots and everything, gloves and everything. And then was unable to get out. Off go the fireworks. Not quite the same fireworks as we see at Valencia, but still a big show. Just makes the championship look so exciting, doesn't it?
That's brilliant. He'll be leading the championship, of course, now leaving here in Jerez. It's a fantastic place. It is. In the background, that's all the bike parks here. Superb. Absolutely superb.
When we were doing the interviews, he would have lost his voice. And they got a chill from jumping in the lake.
As is manager Marcos Hirsch. And here he goes.
He's
not finished yet. Not done and dusted.
No. Well, we saw it earlier in the 125cc race, didn't we? We're not going to tell you who won, but very much the same celebration. Oh, he is happy. Rightly so, that was a great ride.
The image of him jumping in that lake, I'm never going to forget.
No.
But that shot of him there, just the raw emotion from Jorge Lorenzo, incredible scenes here.
I'm just down now in Park Fermo with Danny Pedrosa. Danny, yesterday you told us you didn't have the setup to run consistently, but I got to say, that was a fantastic race today for you.
I just pushed all the way, I just couldn't manage at the end because Lorenzo was too fast, and he was like half second faster than Rossi and me, and he just was going for the win, and I just tried to hold him back in the last two laps, but he make a good pass and that's it. Unfortunately, I get passed in the half lap to go and that's not a good feeling, but compared to Qatar, we are much happier and thanks to the people to come here.
Thank you very much, Danny. Congratulations.
Well, where do we start? Well, we better start with the look at the results. I mean, Jorge Lorenzo wins the race. Danny Pedrosa in second place, Valentino Rossi in third spot, and that's the championship positions now. 4 points between the two Yamaha riders. Lorenzo at the top of the pile. Further down, as you'd expect, a lot of the guys coming into the championship for the first time, just finding it tough. It is tough out there. Bad luck today for Ben Spies. A front tyre problem forced him out of the race.
Still not had the podium ceremony.
No. Just probably going to have it tomorrow at the test.
He just had to send Baywatch out for Jorge Lorenzo. I hope, Ian, you've got your red shorts on there and your life boy.
Both me and Pamela are ready to go.
Pamela Espeleta, the CEO of Dorna, of course, the rights holder of the MotoGP. Just having a word there with Danny Pedrosa. And here we go.
Just going to grab a quick word with the reigning world champion, Valentino Rossi. Valentino, you pushed and pushed and pushed all through that race. But at the end, there is no answer to the two Spaniards.
Yeah, anyway, it's a good result because we have some problem during the practice, and especially I have some problem with my injury shoulder. So the podium is a good result, good point for the championship.
And you'll be back fully fit in Le Mans?
Yeah, I think in 2 weeks, I think so, yeah.
Okay, thanks, Valentino. Congratulations.
Well, getting into a res wasn't so bad. Getting out might not be so easy, mate. 122,000 fans here today. And boy, would they have loved what they've seen, because all the races this afternoon, as often is the way here, 125, Moto2, but the climax was that fabulous duel in the MotoGP race with two Spaniards fighting it out on the very last lap, and Jorge Lorenzo coming out on top when seemingly he was too far behind. And Danny Pedrosa, yeah, I think he in his interview summed it up right. Great ride by him. In the end, there was nothing he could do, but he fought back so bravely when Lorenzo had two real goes at him, didn't he? But in the end, he just knew there was nothing he was going to be able to do. Going to get Lorenzo at some point onto the podium.
He's
there
still,
he is.
Still celebrating.
I'm just going to see if I can grab a quick word with him as he comes past. Jorge! No, he's off somewhere else now.
I think he's got to get to the podium now, hasn't he? He has to rush up there. Yeah, he's taken too long already, hasn't it? Wants to see the podium.
He might have won a race, but Gemma's not having any problems with him here. Come on, Jorge, up to the podium.
Yeah. There we are, winning machines, two Yamahas and a Honda. We said that a few times, haven't we? Ducati fourth and fifth. Nicky Hayden fourth, Casey Stoner fifth. And they've actually got to start fighting back quite strongly at Le Mans and then Mugello, haven't they, Ducati? Certainly Yamaha are going to get away at the front.
I didn't quite tell the whole truth because he was behind Stoner at one point as well.
Yeah, he was, yeah. Hurry them along.
And a bit of a, you know, positive banter there between Pedrosa and Lorenzo, so that's good to see. Their relationship seems to have simmered a bit, doesn't it?
Yeah, recently. I think so. I mean, they were arch enemies at one time. Well, here we go. MotoGP, Jerez 2010. Enjoy, it was just fabulous. At one point, it seemed like it was going off the boil. Hey, got that wrong, didn't we? Podium awaits the arrival of the gladiators. We've spoken to Valentino Rossi, we've spoken to Danny Pedrosa. In a minute we're going to be talking to Jorge Lorenzo. First onto the podium, third place for Valentino Rossi. With all the problems he's had with his shoulder, and as he said, not a bad result for the doctor.
Dani Pedrosa led from the very first corner, and only halfway through that final lap did we know he wasn't, did we think, sorry, that he was going to win the race. And then right at the end, Jorge Lorenzo come out and enjoy the moment of glory on top of the Jerez podium.
Third here 2 years ago in the MotoGP race, crashed out last year in pole position. He didn't fool anybody by any pole positions or taking the lead early on, came late and won the race, and now leads the World Championship after two rounds. Valentino Rossi, precious points for him after winning that opening round in Qatar. Second in the World Championship. He won't be too disappointed. He wants to win every race, but today, this race belonged to two Spaniards. Second place, Dani Pedrosa.
Yeah, well done to Dani Pedrosa as well. It's the FIM president, Mr. Vito Hipólito, who will give Pedrosa with his prize. He'll be disappointed, but he'll know that he's capable of fighting at the front once more. I think that's the main thing for him and for Honda.
But the race winner here this afternoon, and look at that, Dani Pedrosa and Jorge Lorenzo exchanging real pleasantries. I don't think I've ever seen that before. And this place is going to erupt. We've seen one of the classic races. We've seen them here before, Alex Crevier, Mick Doohan, Sete Gibernau and Valentino Rossi. But now another man has written his place into the history books. It's Jorge Lorenzo.
The mayor of Jerez can give over the trophy. It's a kiss for the trophy, not for the mayor.
Yeah.
As Jorge Lorenzo celebrates victory in the Spanish Grand Prix. And just to receive the award for the Fiat Yamaha team, Wilco Zeelenburg is new team manager for this season. He'll be delighted with that.
So for the third time this afternoon, it's the Spanish national anthem. Jorge Lorenzo drops the bottle of champagne. It doesn't break, and the spraying starts. And he's certainly wet enough already after jumping in the lake, so that's not going to be too much of a problem. I hope you enjoyed racing here from Jerez. Everybody's so, so disappointed that there was no second round of the championship in Japan a week ago. Jerez, as always, has more than made up for the disappointment. What a second round of the MotoGP World Championships in the 125 Moto2. And then the real icing on the cake. A fabulous battle for MotoGP with Jorge Lorenzo coming out on top to lead the World Championship after two rounds.